The November 19th, 2024 City Commission meeting is now called to order. Tonight's Pledge of Allegiance will be led by Commissioner Tyson, followed by the invocation by Commissioner Morgan. Will everyone please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we bow our heads. Heavenly Father God, we thank you. You've given us another day, moment, and opportunity as elected officials, Lord God, to come before you and this city to be able to govern for what's best for all of us. We ask that you give us your wisdom, your guidance, but most of our understanding of how to be able to impact this city with the resources that need, as well as our first responders. We thank you for their sacrifice. We thank you for being able to swear in officers today. We give you praise. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. Thank you, commissioners. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Commissioner Arts? Here. Coughlin?
Here.
Moore?
Here.
Morgan?
Here.
Mosley?
Here.
Tyson?
Present.
Mayor Kepley?
Here. Madam Clerk, do you know of any changes to the agenda that you've been made aware of?
No changes.
I haven't either. So Chair will entertain a motion for to approve the agenda as submitted.
Move approval.
Move approval from support. Commissioner Morgan. Support from Mosley. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, nay. Motion passes. So at this time, we want to acknowledge visitors that wish to speak to non-agenda items. If there's anybody that would like to come forward, state your name, your address, let us know what's on your mind. All right, seeing none, we'll continue on. The consent agenda is before you, commissioners. Chair will entertain a motion for its approval.
Move approval.
From Morgan, and support or second?
Support.
Second from Mosley. With that, all those in favor signify. Oh, I'm sorry. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Commissioner Arts?
Yes.
Coughlin?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Morgan?
Yes.
Mosley?
Yes.
Tyson?
Yes.
Mayor Kepley?
Yes. Motion passes. Item 8 is the approval of the City Commission minutes held on November 13th, 2024 is distributed. Are there any changes or corrections to the minutes? Seeing none, Chair will entertain a motion for its approval as distributed.
Move approval.
Motion by Commissioner Arts.
Support.
Support by Coughlin. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, nay. The minutes are approved. All right. Big time. Swearing in of officers. The Fire Lieutenant Ryan Rickardson, Fire Inspector Kevin Madey, and Firefighter Chad Wilson. Chief, the floor is yours.
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. This evening we are swearing in three different positions, so we will have all three up here in just a moment, and then we'll do three separate oaths before they make their rounds. So if I could have Chad Wilson come up first. Chad is our new hire, just started this week, and was born and raised in Florida and spent 8 years in Colorado, where he worked 2.5 years with the Cortez Fire District in Cortez, Colorado. He's with his girlfriend and son Oliver, moved to Grand Rapids back in August from Colorado, and he had tested with us previous to that. And we're happy, they're happy, not we, they wrote these. he's happy to be in West Michigan, and then we have made that hire after he moved back to the area. So we're happy to have Chad Wilson. Ryan Rickardson, if you could come up, please. Ryan grew up in the Kentwood, Wyoming area, went to Kelloggsville Public Schools, and obtained a bachelor's degree in emergency service from Bethel University. Worked in law enforcement for 11 years and started in the city of Kentwood as a cadet for the police department. Worked as a police officer until June of 2019, ending the career with the Grand Rapids Police Department. Started with the fire service, working with Thornapple Township Emergency Services and Yankee Springs Fire Department, and was hired by the city of Kentwood in 2019. Worked as a firefighter through all of our stations, became a member of our tech rescue and hazmat teams. So we're glad to have Ryan moving up in the ranks. Kevin Madey. Kevin has just been promoted to fire inspector. He was a lieutenant and just moved into the fire inspector spot. Grew up in Ottawa County, graduated from Jenison High School, was influenced to join the fire service by his father, Tim, who retired from Kentwood a few years back. Kevin also began his career working in the city of Granville and Georgetown and Plainfield Townships. Kevin had begun with Kentwood 7.5 years and has been here 7.5 years and is a member of the Hizmat team and lives in Hudsonville with his wife and boys. And Kevin spends a lot of time watching his boys play hockey and baseball. In his free time, he enjoys spending time with his family on their boat and plays some golf. So welcome to Kevin. And if I could have the clerk come up.
So as the clerk is coming up, if you're a family member, if you want to come forward and you can stand in front of us to get video or pictures, please do so. We're going to pause and allow you time to just come forward. Please walk in front. This is a good view. And so you come forward. You can get in our way. You're not blocking. Just get that great angle.
You can come in front of me.
Can you come in front of us? And so we'll pause. And when I think I see all the cameras up and running, I'll let the clerk know. I think. Hold on. We got one. Are you good, Mom? Okay.
Oh, we're good.
Okay. All right. Let's go.
Congratulations. I love working with you.
I miss him.
Very proud of you.
Hey, brother. Good. Congratulations. Absolutely. Hey, welcome to the city.
Thank you. Congratulations. Thank you for everything.
No, that's not easy.
Yeah, thank you. Really fast.
Right.
Thank you.
It's always an exciting time, so some of you already know. Made, if you want to, you have some friends, family here, please introduce them.
Yeah, my wife and my two boys, Kyler and Dex.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I have my wife, Megan, and then my son, Jackson, my daughter, Shaylin, and my dad and my mom.
Excellent.
And I just have my girlfriend, Carly, here. Her son wasn't able to make it tonight, but... he's here as well.
All right. Well, yes. Congratulations. It's nice to meet you all. We know that we can't do our job without our family. And so thank you, Mom and Dad, for all you did to all that you did to place great things in your son to that we get to experience, right? So thank you so much how you brought him up. Thank you for the girlfriend and spouses that really, without you, I know that they can't do the job. So thank you so much. This is definitely a family affair. So we really appreciate all you do as we serve the city of Kentwood, right? That's what we're here for, is to serve the residents the best we can. So welcome to our family, and we will support them and pray for them all the time. So thank you. So I know you want to stay for the rest of the meeting. We have a great meeting, but we're going to pause. We'll allow you to exit gracefully. You can take some pictures out in the hall. And again, thank you so much for coming, and thank you for all your investment in your sons. Thank you. So Chief Lemon, you want to go first? Okay. Give me a chart on my end. Oh, you got it.
That'll hold the button a little longer.
Yep.
Okay. Mayor and Commissioners, good evening. This is the October 2024 fire report in front of you. We were responded to 10 fires last month and 355 EMS calls. So we're down about 15% for fires year to date. and up about just over 7% for EMS year to date. And then you can see the breakdown for hazardous condition service calls, good intent, and false alarms for a total run volume last month of 502. So we're at total after October is 4,447, so we're up about 7% total runs for year to date. Fire on North Rosebud, 32nd Street, and you can see the breakdown there for other grass fires, brush fires, and trash fires. Through that, the October report, the next box down for mutual aid. So three given to Cascade and two back from Cascade to us. Five to Cutlerville, nothing back on our end, and two with Dutton, and one from Grand Rapids, and three to Wyoming. We continue to work with Wyoming on the automatic aid agreement, or what we just call box cards now for automatic aid. So we will have that resolution here pretty soon. We have some geographic boundaries drawn up, and as far as automatic response, in their city commission is going to approve that. EMS calls for service down there, breathing problem at the highest at 50, or almost the highest at 50, falls at 51, and then traffic accidents at 15, and that's kind of the breakdown for high numbers there, chest pain at 32. No fire service casualties or injuries to report, and then no Narcan administered. So down over 50% year to date for Narcan administration. If we could turn to page two. Top left corner for fire prevention activities. So 26 plan reviews done, one new construction, remodel, sprinkler plans, as you can see, and site plans. Also one fire alarm hood system. Annual business inspections, total of 206 inspections done last month. And the breakdown's there for reinspections and initial annuals. And then two CFOs issued. Jumping down to smoke detector installations at 46 and 13 CO alarms. So down a little bit, just over 3% year to date on smoke alarm installs, but we're up significantly on the carbon monoxide detector installations. The chemical surveys are back, only got three returns, so we're down significantly for the return on those. And then you can see the five-year total construction and five-year total inspections. We are sitting at full staffing now with Kevin Madej in the office doing inspections. So we're back to, and then Chad Wilson rounds that out also with the new firefighter we just swore in. So we are back to full staffing. On the picture there, this is a vehicle that we had around 7 o'clock on, just after 7 o'clock on October 10. This vehicle was actually westbound on 44th Street and turned left to go southbound because they thought the road went southbound. And it went through the garage and out the back and down the embankment and hit a tree. So it was an interesting call, say the least. But we knew what, as soon as they told us it went through the house at 44th and Schaefer, we knew it was one of two houses because those are both an interesting location. So thankfully, no one was in the garage. There was no cars in the garage. So the vehicle very easily went through the front and out the back. And bounced off the back corner of the house and down the embankment. So there was a couple adults and a child in that vehicle. One was transported for observation to get checked out. And as I mentioned, we are back to full staff. We're pretty happy with that. Our inspections department is going through some training yet. The fire inspector, Brian Johnson, we swore in a couple months ago, just went through his inspection school. And Kevin Madej will be going through inspection school here shortly. So it'll be very helpful to have those certified people in place and get our inspections caught up. So I'll entertain any question, Mayor and Commissioners.
Okay, thank you. Commissioner Morgan.
Was this drunk driver?
No, just driving.
Just driving.
You're the opposite side of the road.
I mean, just driving that quick to embankment straight through.
Interesting. No, they didn't go straight through. They were westbound 44th and turned left at the light to go southbound. The road doesn't go south.
They were going on 44th west towards your church, right?
Yeah.
And they instead of taking right on Schaefer, they took a left.
Was it GPS that told them to go that way?
I didn't ask. I didn't want to go there. Well,
the other question I have is in regards to, we approved prior new suits that were free from PFAS.
Yes.
And that I had some questions.
Talking about the state grant?
Yes.
Yes.
How's that going?
It's going very well. They just gave us the first $41,000 towards it.
Okay.
So basically, we spend the money they're reimbursing us up to $67,000. So we just actually got a check last week or the week before. Finance indicated that we got our first check for $41,000.
So you'll be getting the suits, or is this reimbursement
for
you already got?
We've already purchased the suits. Yeah, okay. They're already coming in. Yep. So, and it's just an annual replacement. We replace about anywhere from about 8 to 15 sets of turnout gear every year. So this was just $67,000 doesn't cover a lot. It's $3,950 a set for pants and coat. So it's expensive. So we're just replacing it as it dates out. So the turnout gear has a shelf life per se of 10 years. So the NFPA and OSHA requires that at a 10-year mark that gear goes away, and then we have to replace it. Everybody's got two sets to maintain a clean set. So everybody has two sets of gear. So every 5 years, we're replacing a person's set of gear. So their oldest set, when it becomes 10, goes away.
So that means some have new gear with no PFAS, some
Correct.
Have current gear with PFAS.
Correct.
Which asks the question prior in regards to the health conditions of our officers for long-term PFAS
Correct.
Not being able to deteriorate the body. So, okay.
Yep, we are replacing the gear as quickly and by budget constraints that we can. Yep. So we are replacing, I would tell you we are at about 30 sets out of 54 people that are in PFAS-free gear right now. Anything after April of 2021 is PFAS-free. So anything we've ordered since April of 2021 is PFAS-free.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
But we continue to our due diligence to get that stuff out of there. So.
Yes.
We've even found it in our gloves, and I've just actually changed manufacturers of gloves, finding it in our gloves. So we are now buying a PFAS-free fire glove.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay.
Your shards.
Are there consequences for not returning your chemical inventory surveys?
No, you just get another one next year. But some of these go out of business. We're tasking the fire inspectors, the two inspectors and the marshal, to ask when they get there to ask if they've got chemical surveys that have not been turned in. But there is no consequence, no.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
So while the chief is here, I know that the RFP for the design of the training center went out. Have we received those back yet?
Yes.
Okay, and?
They just came in Thursday.
Thursday, so we're still reviewing.
They'll be either on December 3 or December 17.
Okay, excellent. That's great.
Yes.
We're excited about that.
Yep, you bet.
Absolutely. Okay, thank you, chief.
Thank you.
We're good. I'm good. Good. All right. All right, Chief, floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor, Commissioners. In front of you, you have a copy of our October 2024 monthly report. For the month, we had calls for service, about 1,509 calls. Those were up. And then October, then overall year to date, 14,812. For violent crime, we had one CSC complaint, three robbery complaints. Of those, one involved a knife with a potential prostitution incident where cash was taken, one at Vets Park with a gun was implied, and another one with a carjacking involving pepper spray on those. Aggravated assaults, we had 14 for the month. Of those 12, the suspect and victim knew each other. Two of those were unknown. And the ones that stood out, one of those was a stabbing, and the other one involved where a house was shot after an altercation, and somebody drove by shot into the house. Nobody was injured. For property crimes, we had one arson last month at JC Park where a trash can was lit on fire that turned out to be a juvenile. In that case, we had 12 burglary complaints last month. We had 92 larceny complaints. Those were up. 35 of those were retail frauds, 22 were larceny from vehicles, and 27 were others were the main three that stood out last month. Motor vehicle thefts, we had for the month, we had six of those where the suspect and victim knew each other when the vehicle was taken. I spoke too soon last month because this month we had seven Kias or Hyundais that were either stolen or attempted. Because of the 16 total, 12 were actually stolen and then four were attempts. So if they were trying a Kia or a Hyundai, trying to steal that, but if either unable to or due to the new safety features that they've put in from Kia and Hyundai, prevented that from happening. Our non-index crimes, main ones that stood out, we had 81 non-aggravated assaults, simple assaults, 14 weapon complaints, and 14 drunk driving arrests last month. For arrests, our adults, we had 126 adult arrests. Those were up. And then we had 23 juvenile arrests, which those were down compared to last year. Traffic complaints. So traffic complaints for the month, we had 105 property damage, 42 personal injury. Those were up significantly from last year. Citations, we had 311 tickets were written and 827 traffic stops. So both of those were up from the year before. And then kind of jumping back up there to the top, code complaints. For the month, we had 195 total. 164 of those were corrected by the owner. 10 were corrected by the city. 4 were found not to be in violation. 7 were referred to other departments. And we issued 10 citations last month. And then for the Woodland Mall, last month we had a total of 40 calls for service, which were down compared to 48 from the year before. And they just pushed with Woodland Mall. They're implementing a new juvenile policy on Saturdays where they anybody under 18 needs to be accompanied by an adult after, I believe, 6 p.m. That they've actually pushed that now. I believe the first or second weekend now of December, they've pushed that too. They were planning on starting that coming up this weekend, but they've, for some internal things, they've pushed that a few weeks. Survey standpoint, we had 36 people responded to our surveys last month. So out of 206 were completed with a 97% satisfaction rate from our citizens on our service. Injuries last month, four officers, you'll see the list of injuries there. That was all from one incident where our officers responded and with a family and ended up arresting one of the individuals there. When our officers were actually getting ready to leave, it was a domestic complaint. Suspect initially didn't come out. Our officers were to the point ready to leave and seek a warrant. When the suspect came out of the house, they went and talked to him. Became very uncooperative, told him he was under arrest. He tried to flee then. One of our officers tackled him. In the process, family members jumped on top of our officers, and we ended up taking a number of family members to jail. In the middle, of course, the Sheriff's Department responded to help our officers. We had like six officers there, and all those injuries were from that one incident there. Fortunately, nothing severe, but just kind of things our officers deal with on a daily basis. So. Going there and all this, it simply just had to comply and chose not to. With that then the pictures there you're seeing, the one there is drone footage. It was from a missing runaway. So we put the drone up and we're able to locate the runaway fairly quickly using our drone at night with a thermal. The upper right picture there, you'll see the pink badge. Our officers worked with our badge company, reached out to them and basically came up with this pink badge design where officers themselves, we put it out, they actually went and purchased that themselves, and we allowed them to wear that for the month of October for breast cancer awareness. And then part of that fund, part of the money that we took from that, the extra money went towards actually the Susan B. Komen breast cancer awareness thing here locally. And then the bottom is our officers, a couple of our officers there for trunk or treat this past Halloween. So, that, if you have any questions.
Okay. Commissioner.
I've seen some Ring camera footage from a couple of different sources, one in Princeton Estates and one actually a friend of ours that lives on the other side of 52nd Street, where someone is trying to break into their home, regardless of the fact that there's a camera there. They're dressed in all black and they have a black mask on, and you can tell they have like red tennis shoes. But the strangest thing about it is one was at 6 a.m. and one was at 6:30 a.m. and the people were awake and moving around their homes at that time. Do you know anything about that?
No, that's the first I've heard about that. I can look into that and find out if
I guess I just wondered if
on that.
Those are two isolated instances, or if this has been happening a lot. I saw the so I guess my next question is, if someone reports that someone's trying to break into their house, is that considered a burglary?
Typically, yes, it should fall under that. Yep.
So one of them did get into the home.
Okay.
But if I'm not mistaken, they both had dogs barking and that didn't even stop them. So just kind of odd at 6 and 6:30 in the morning, and you can tell by the Ring camera timestamp.
I will look into that. Let you know.
So, just for for information, if someone has that, can they not send that to the police through email or that sort of thing?
Yes. So they can send that through Ring. A few years ago, we used to be able to we could actually push something out through the system, and they actually took that away from law enforcement, where we could reach out to anybody who had a Ring camera and say, hey, we're looking for somebody in the area. If you have something, please, we'd appreciate it. Here's the link or whatever to do that. And they've taken that ability away from us. So we'll push it out on social media or other ways to let people know. But Ring took that away from us a couple of years ago.
Okay. But the technology is the fact that they could have sent it to the police department?
Yep.
And maybe they did. Yep. They both said that they called the police.
Okay.
So.
Well, that's good. So you have a record on it. Okay. Excellent. Anything else? All right. Thank you, Chief.
Good. Thank you.
Chair will entertain a motion to receive and file the police and fire reports.
So
motion and support by Moore. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, nay. Motion passes. We're at communications and petitions for 10A. It's approved land division for parcel property located at 1800 44th Street. Lisa, the floor is yours.
Commissioners, this is related to the Storage 5 development. You recall we rezoned the back part of this parcel. It is a platted area, and you will also recall that they said they're going to have outlots along the 44th Street frontage. This is the first outlot. They happened to choose one lot that they wanted to divide into two, and so that increases the number of lots in the subdivision and therefore requires City Commission approval. They will probably come in for the other four that they have planned along the 44th Street frontage, but this is the first of those.
Okay. And staff approval is recommendation?
Correct.
Okay, Commissioner Morgan.
Just a little bit thrown off due to perspective. Where's Mr. Berger, or is that the daycare? Just trying to understand how these parcels are split.
Mr. Berger is to the west. I think it's right here.
Yeah. That's Mr. Berger right there? Okay. Yeah. I wasn't sure if that was another separate parcel.
Yes.
So there's still the four. Was there four at the top by 44th?
Four, yeah.
Okay. And
then there was one in the back near the church.
Did that still get taken by GR Church?
I don't know. I don't know if Mayor has any update.
Nope. I have not heard recently.
I have not heard that they have.
So is this parcel split in regards to a perspective?
Correct.
Okay. So we do have some traction with this.
Yes. It's going to be an oil change place.
Oh, they did get the Jiffy Lube. Interesting. Yep. Good. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions, comments? Seeing none, Chair will entertain a motion.
Move approval.
Motion. Is there a second?
Support.
There's support by Mosley. Any other questions, comments? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, nay. Motion passes. We have bids. We'll start with the first one. Authorized contract for City Hall HVAC system upgrades. Chad?
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. Before you, for your consideration this evening, is to authorize the mayor to enter into a contract with Train Incorporated for the refurbishment of our energy recovery unit here at City Hall and the dehumidification system as well, with a total not to exceed of $329,550, including a 10% contingency, using funds from the Property and Buildings Fund. Essentially, the ERU here provides fresh air to the entire building. There's a heat pump system here as well, and all of the heat pumps receive that fresh air from the ERU. Fresh air comes in through the building and exhaust air goes through it. There's two different types of sensible wheels that are in this unit. One's a sensible wheel, one's an enthalpy wheel. And essentially, they take heated air and exchange it in for the, in through the cooled air. And so that it rotates in between the two streams of air, which provides energy efficiency while providing fresh air for the all of our both users of the City Hall and staff as well. In addition to this, there's a dehumidification system. It's called a multi-stack. We're going to upgrade that system to a chiller type system, which will be much more efficient. It's a modulating system, which is great from an energy efficiency standpoint, but also many of the people who visit City Hall and many of the employees also know how humid it feels in City Hall through the summer months, and this will greatly help with pulling that humidification, that humidity, excuse me, out of the air. We are utilizing an energy efficiency and conservation block grant under the bipartisan infrastructure law for $118,000. And if you might remember, we had originally planned on utilizing that grant for the energy upgrades that we did for all of the city buildings, which included a lot of lighting upgrades, many, many LED lights that we did for that. Unfortunately, the timing and requirements for that did not align with that, but we're able to utilize that with this project. So it is still a win-win here for us for this. So this is a SCI identified project, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have at this time.
Any questions? Go ahead, Commissioner Moore.
So with the money not being used for the LED lights, will that be something we'll have to get another grant for next year or something? Or
no, we were able to complete that project and under budget as well, including what was originally identified in the SCI, even excluding the 118. So yeah, we're in good shape for that project.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any other questions, comments? Okay. Motion by Moore.
Support.
Support by Arts. There's no more questions or comments. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. This was nay. Motion passes. 13B is authorized contract for city facility trash and recycling services. Continue on.
Yes, sir. Thank you much. Mm-hmm. For your consideration this evening, we're looking at renewing our contract with GFL, Green for Life, city trash and recycling services, for a three-year period from 25 to 27 with the option to renew for two additional one-year periods with funds from applicable general fund department budgets for each of the fiscal years of this contract. So various city facilities utilize roll-off dumpsters for both trash and recycling. It is single-stream recycling that we utilize through GFL. GFL has had great service with us. Customer service is excellent. They are always on time and picking up dumpsters and have been great to work with. We're recommending GFL as you know, picking up the contract again for these next 5 years. They are a touch more expensive than waste management is, and especially in years 3, 4, and 5. But the savings that we'll see by going with them and not having to change everything over at every city building will more than pay for itself. So staff recommend the GFL for this three-year term with the option for two additional years under special circumstances. So be happy to answer any questions here as well.
So just to clarify, special circumstances, you bid this, you have the results, this is in the best interest. Does it really need special circumstances? It's a staff recommendation.
It's not the low bid, so yes, special circumstances.
Okay. All right. So any other questions, comments?
I'm sorry, I'm trying to get clear. It's going to save money in the long term. Is that right, Chad? I'm sorry.
It will, based on our staff labor to do the swap over. And we also reached out to some of the references as well for the low bid, and were steered away.
Any other questions?
Move approval.
Motion.
Support.
And there's support by Mosley.
Support.
Yes, all right, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? Motion passes. Next is approval purchase of 9 Chevrolet Tahoes. Tahoes.
Tahoes.
Tahoes.
Mayor and Commissioners, in front of you have our purchase request for our new, for our replacement fleet for new vehicles for 9 Chevy Tahoes. Total cost includes the cost of the vehicles plus upfitting as far as equipment, accessories, decals, not to exceed $700,001 from our fiscal year 25 police equipment fund. We typically do a 4-year rotation on our vehicles, so about 100,000 miles, and we rotate, so this is the next set that'll be due to be rotated out. A couple of years ago, we transitioned from Chargers. We had driven those for years. Dodge stopped producing those. We're going electric with those vehicles. They are now doing the same thing with the Durangos. So they are stopping production on the Durangos and going electric with those. So they're going to be coming out, their next vehicle they're going to be coming out with, their, from what we're told, is called the Stealth, but it's basically similar size based off of like the Jeep Wagoneer that you've seen, that that frame and style, but that's not available yet. So it leaves us with two options, one being the Tahoe, the other one being the Ford Explorer or Interceptor, is what they call the police model. Talking with multiple agencies that are had the Ford Explorers, they're all looking to go away from them because of mechanical issues very early on in the front end when they're down with things that should not be breaking after a few thousand miles and problems they're having. So we looked into that, and basically leaves us with the Tahoes as kind of our only option as far as knowing vehicles that are going to be dependable and we're going to have out there for this. So that's the reason why we are going with these.
Tahoes.
Tahoes.
Okay. Commissioner Morgan.
Outside of the fact that the mayor loves saying Tahoes.
Well, you got to understand. I mean, we have gone through some cars here. And, you know, it's like you try to be consistent,
yep.
Right? And, you know, when in 2003, when I started, we had
Ford Crown Vicks.
Crown Vicks, right?
Great car.
Great, yeah.
There, yeah.
So we've gone through some cars, and so the next chapter is Tahoes. Yeah.
So with that being stated, how much of the lack of fuel efficiency versus the other vehicles that we had is the how much are we going to see increasing in regards to cost of maintenance, fuel efficiency, and everything else?
Don't know on as far as comparing that with city driving compared to the Durangos. Hard to really have a comparison as far as at this point. I think this is kind of the only, like I said, we're looking at options for vehicles that are going to be dependable and that we have. The next, and everybody's moving towards electric, but there's a lot of issues, I think, from a law enforcement standpoint because of all the electronics we run that they're not designed to handle yet. It's not just driving the car, but it's the radios, the computers, the cameras, lights, that it's gonna drain those batteries extremely fast. And then how long does it take to recharge? So, I mean, that's something down the future. I hope that's not my problem. be the next chief's problem to figure that out. But those are things we've talked about with things upcoming with the Justice Center and our parking lot, as far as charging stations and all that kind of looking at. But I would expect our fuel cost is going to go up a little bit with the Tahoes, but I don't anticipate it being substantial compared to those. We've driven them for our supervisor vehicles for a number of years. We had some engine issues with those, but they've fixed that from what we've been told. That's kind of more on the top end. So as the mileage got higher and the hours on there. So yeah, we're just kind of waiting to see, well, how that's going to play out.
So is are we trying to escape additional cost increase by purchasing these now versus later?
Yeah, so that's our option right now, those and the Fords. And from what we've talked about, a couple bigger departments that are going away from the Fords that have driven them for years because of maintenance issues and being down. I mean, it might be a little more fuel efficient, but if you don't have the car to get there, it doesn't do us any good. So we got to have the cars for our personnel to get there. I'll be honest, it's not necessarily my first choice. I think it's a little big for city driving, but it's really kind of the only option at this point that we have, that we feel, to make sure we got something that's dependable.
So we're not, I mean, the reason I'm saying we're not going to see, like, if we're saving $1 million like we do with the fire department if we get a truck now versus the...
No. This is our normal rotation. Okay. So this is our 9 cars that are coming out plus adding, we're adding officers, we're adding vehicles. So one of these is being added to that. But this isn't like, hey, we're buying 9 now because next year it's going to be, no, this is to replace what's due to come out right now.
The normal cycle.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
So there's a story out there, I think it was in Michigan, they had bought 2 electric vehicles for their police officers. They loaded up and the thing wouldn't work, so they used them for inspections. Anyway, with that, any other questions or comments?
Move approval.
Move approval, Coughlin. Support. Support Arts. If there's no more discussions, seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, nay. Motion passes. Thank you, Chief. 13D, authorized contract for engineering services for Division Avenue pedestrian improvements. Mr. Kirkwood.
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. It's requested that the City Commission authorize the mayor to execute a contract for design and construction engineering services with Rowe Professional Services Company for pedestrian improvements on Division Avenue in an amount not to exceed $86,020, including a 10% contingency with funds from the major street funds. We applied last spring for a safety grant for a mid-block crossing where there's 2 schools over there between Elwell and Leroy on Division Avenue, and we rewarded, so we're getting 90% of construction covered by the grant, and then we will split this $86,000 with Wyoming, and then we'll have to cover just the final 10% of construction, half of that us, half of it Wyoming.
So, go ahead, Commissioner Arts, go ahead.
I didn't have a question, I just had a comment. This is probably one of the things that we need most in our city. I have seen kids almost get hit on the street, and this is the best money that we could have spent.
So my question is, so Wyoming had to agree with Roe. So you know, and you usually went through an RFP process. We didn't hear. Understand they did the studies.
Oh, sorry. Yes, they did the original study for this.
So basically, you know, the thought, I guess, is they're familiar with the project. Mm-hmm. I mean, how do you know that we're getting a good price from Roe versus going out with an RFP?
They've been low on the other traffic projects that we've had. They did the Stauffer light replacement just, what was that, 2 summers ago? And they had very good pricing for that as well, and good services.
Was there any way you could compare the prices to other projects, Hawk System designs elsewhere, that they were in the ballpark at least?
There, as far as design, the bulk of this $86,000 is $52,000 for construction administration, of which $25,000 alone is MDOT required inspection at the manufacturing plant to see that the mast arms are being constructed appropriately. Okay. And meet testing.
So you said 52, so that leaves
About 30,000.
Yeah, 34.
Actually, okay. I think they were around 26 or 28,000 for
okay.
design.
Okay. All right.
So that's where we felt things were in line.
Okay. Commissioner Morgan.
Just for clarification, understand that Elwood and Leroy go east and west across
yep.
Division. There's currently a light at 48th Street and Division. Are we talking about putting an additional crossing light?
This will be mid-block crossing.
Yeah.
So this would only flash if somebody presses the button, and it would go through yellow and then red. So it would not be cycling normally like your intersection traffic lights.
Would it be like a middle island
yep.
spot there, and then kids can...
Yeah, they'd have a refuge island in the middle.
Okay.
And then there'd be lights on northbound and southbound, stopping traffic so they can cross the street.
Okay. Makes sense. Thank you.
Yep.
So we're definitely going to have to have education piece. I know they have a Hawk down in Grand Rapids. But, you know, just to make sure that when the lights are, you know, this is going to be our first one, and you definitely needed some education piece.
Yeah, this will be different than the other system, which only flashes yellow.
Right.
This will stop put cars. A yellow up first and then a red light. And so people should understand I have to stop.
Yep. Education.
This is a bit similar to one downtown. By
yes.
The,
mm-hmm. Right.
So if just does it cycle through, or does as long as somebody's staying there, does it stay on that red for the? I'm just thinking about kids playing, and I just love to press that button. Apparently,
there's always been that, but from what we've heard, is generally people don't tend to mess with the buttons. I mean, you're not going to say that there isn't going to be a kid every once in a while, but. We've asked that question before because kids wanna, and everyone says that they doesn't seem to happen.
Okay.
So others that have them.
So this is in direct, as you exit the middle school, it's straight out that main road, and that's where the crossing is gonna be.
Right.
Going straight to the
middle school. I can't remember. There's, on one side I think is a middle school, and the other side is either high school or elementary.
Yeah.
And then there's a after school program right there too. It's right at this door. Okay. All right, any other questions, comments?
Move approval.
Motion by Arts.
Support.
Support by Tyson. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed nay. Motion passes. Last on the bids is authorized contract for ClearGov budgeting suites software. Kayla, you have the floor.
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. Today I am requesting that the City Commission authorize the Mayor to sign a contract with ClearGov for the purchase of ClearGov's budgeting suites and the digital budget book for up to 5 years at a total cost not to exceed $150,000 with funds from the general fund, contingent upon Commission's approval of this funding in each year's budget. So ClearGov is a cloud-based software that will vastly improve efficiency across some of the city's most tedious and laborious tasks, such as capital planning, personnel budgeting, operational budgeting, and financial forecasts. The software will also greatly enhance the transparency with our community and our stakeholders by making public information more accessible and financial information easier to read. So ClearGov offers a variety of suites, but the ones we are requesting are capital, personnel, operation, and then the digital budget book. So what this would do is it would allow department heads to submit requests and prioritize capital projects. For personnel budgeting, it would help us with personnel costs, position requests, union negotiation planning and scenarios, and multi-year forecasts. And then with the operational budget, again, it's going to streamline everything in one software and remove the work or some of the work that the finance department has with putting everything together. So I do anticipate a reduction in overall work hours that it takes for us during a whole budget season, and then also a better budget to present to the community and to us and the staff. So the proposed pricing is piggybacking on a national purchasing cooperative. That co-op is competitively bid, so it does meet city standards. The purchase was not originally budgeted in 2025, so a budget amendment will be presented at a later date if this is approved. I demoed it. My staff demoed it, and everybody is really excited about it. Maybe it's not as exciting as other softwares that we've seen, but it's really, it's exciting for us because it's going to give us the ability to display our financial numbers in nice graphs right in the system, integrate everything in one place without having to go out to an Excel spreadsheet, make the graphs there, then put it to a PDF and add it to all of the rest of our documents. So I do think that our department heads are also going to like the features that are going to be available to them. I am open to any questions at this time.
So I will say this, Kayla brought this to my attention, and, you know, always cautious about, is it needed, and how does it pay for itself? And we really think once we start using this, this will save a lot of time for employees. And so in the future, when there's changes, retirements, this might help make those decisions where we can no longer takes, you know, 20% of your year, and that will free up some time where maybe we can save on staff costs.
Just curious, when it's gonna, as soon as you guys can get it installed and everything, be up and running?
Yeah, if the mayor is authorized to sign the contract, I have the contract ready with me so I can submit it tomorrow. We're excited, and our budget season does start taking our work in finance starting in December, so we're like right on time to get it rolling. And so as soon as we can is when we would be available to get it going. And it's cloud-based, so it's really nice that you know, we would have that integration, and we would be hopefully ready to go within a week.
Mm-hmm. So there's, you know, can be some changes taking place in a couple of years. You know, it's $7,000 for the setup fee, and you know, if it doesn't work, we can always, you know.
Right. So if it doesn't work, we basically just locked in the price for the 5 years. But if it doesn't work, we have 60 days to cancel. So if it's not really what it is, or there's budget constraints, and we just go back to our previous ways, that's okay.
But this is a possibility once we have a year or two under our belts to say how much has this really saved us, so we can make some this, as always, whether it be BSNA suites, we have saved a lot of staff time and FTEs because we get good software that does a great job. This could be one of those. Okay, Commissioner Moore.
A couple of questions is, and you could probably just go answer them straight across. How many other software programs have we tried before we settled on this one? Does it have AI capabilities that's making it easier? Is there a maintenance process or the software, or is there a cost for the updates? So again, how many of you tried AI maintenance updates?
So for trying, all we would have in the past was just straight into the BSNA system, which their budgeting process is very manual and very and not very innovative. I did speak with them to say, what is your cloud version budgeting portion look like? And they did admit there's some changes, but that it wouldn't be to this capability. Other budgeting softwares, if you go with them, you have to buy the whole financial suite. And that's not what we wanted to do. We don't need a whole financial suite. We just needed, this is like a budgeting add-on. So this was going to be the best program to fit the additional needs we want. We did do some free demos of other programs, since this one was the best. There are about 30 municipalities in Michigan who use it, but they are nationwide, and the latest that's adding on was City of Wyoming. They just approved this yesterday. Next question was
maintenance and software updates.
Yeah, so maintenance, since it is cloud-based, we get free upgrades pushed to us. We do get the ability to submit requests if we want a feature added, and the feedback that we've received from other communities is that they listen and that the upgrades are integrated. Sorry, my brain is...
You're good.
All right, any other questions or comments? Okay. Chair will entertain a motion.
Motion to approve.
Motion approved. Mosley, support by Moore. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, nay. Motion passes. Thank you. Last is a resolution to establish City Commission meeting dates.
Yes.
As you maybe have read the resolution, there's certain Tuesdays are moved throughout the year because of spring break, MML. Capital, of course, elections. So, are we talking about elections for next year? Isn't that crazy?
Move approval.
Support.
And support.
Question.
Yeah, question. Go ahead.
Reason between November the 12th versus the 10th, or April the 14th versus the 17th, those being on Wednesdays and Thursdays?
So, November 10th is Veterans Day, right? It would be closed.
November 11th actually is Veterans Day, which is Tuesday. But that's a normal planning commission day.
Oh, that's right, okay.
So planning is moved to Monday, and City Commission is going to Wednesday.
Okay. Okay. I knew veterans had to play in there. All right, got it.
And then April 14th versus 17th?
That's budget.
Budget meeting. Thursday.
Yeah, we do it on Thursday.
Close on Thursday.
Well, we started it maybe in 2021.
Long enough.
It gives you a couple more days to study the budget.
Gotcha.
So, all right. So we have a motion. We have support. Any other discussion? This is a resolution, it's a roll call vote. Will the clerk please call the roll?
Commissioner Coughlin?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Morgan?
Yes.
Mosley?
Yes.
Tyson?
Yes.
Arts?
Yes.
Mayor Kepley?
Yes, the resolution has been approved. That is it for the agenda. Comments, commissioners? I'll start on my right. Commissioner Mosley, you have anything? Go forward. We're good.
This is the last time to be before Thanksgiving, so happy Thanksgiving, everybody.
Yes.
Thank you.
Don't burn the turkey. All right. Anybody else? Sabo, thank you so much for being here. Anybody back there? We're good. Kiosha, thank you so much for being here. Good. Okay, with that, Chair would entertain a motion for adjournment.
So, support.
All right, motion of support. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Aye. Those opposed, nay. Stand adjourned.
You too.